how difficult is it to balance the fact that you've got these fans that know the product already, mm-hmm. and then you've got this new series, but you've got to satisfy both?
I think that, here's the thing, I think books, television, film, they're all different mediums and they require different things. When I read the books, I fell in love with these characters. I fell in love with the town of Midnight. In terms of the plot of the books, there was a small town pace to the story, mm-hmm. that just by virtue of being in network television, and Charlaine and I have talked about it and she understands, that it needs like a little bit more engine. So for me, I think of them as two very different things. I love the books, and I love the show. And they have a really different energy, but the characters are the same, and the world is the same, and the themes are the same. So I'm hopeful that people can read the books and love the books, and then see this version of the books brought to life, and it's not exactly the same, but it still fills the need. And I think that the characters, their hearts are really similar. I tried to keep the spirit of who they were very close to the books, so hopefully it won't be a disappointment.
So for people who haven't read the books, I've seen the first two episodes, and there's the supernatural aspect is not traditional in a lot of like ways. Can you talk a little bit about how the vampire, for instance, it's not your typical vampire.
No.
So what's the lore behind these supernatural characters?
We learn, every episode you'll learn about a new character. So episode 2, you'll learn about the Rev and why he's freaked out by the full moon. And so I think that what we do is take one episode to sort of unpack each character. So episode 3, you'll learn about Lem. And Lem is a very untraditional vampire. He both can have blood. He also feeds leeches emotion, leeches energy. And we learn how that came to be for Lem. So I think we try and sort of explore why there are different versions of this. Does that answer your question? I'm sorry. Floundered there by the end of this. Yes.
I think the first episode, when watching it, I also was able to see it in the panel. There's a lot of elements of sexuality, and there's also a grittiness that isn't really fully like explored as much as it could be on like a network like NBC. Mm-hmm. Is there a reason why you NBC chose to have this type of show? Because I think if like for True Blood, the books were very violent, uh-huh. And had so much blood and gore,
yes.
and so HBO was able to kind of explore
right.
that kind of realm. And I think with Midnight Texas, I loved the show, the first episode, uh-huh. but I feel like there could be a little bit more explored, but maybe not because it's on NBC.
Well, I think that one of the things, and one of the reasons why I wanted to develop this for NBC is when you read the books, it's about community and love. Mm-hmm. True Blood was always about desire, sex, and blood.
Yes.
Like, it really was. That was the theme from that first frame where they come in with the blood. Like, that's the... And so we're dealing with a different theme. So when I read the books, I was like, this is a theme that fits perfectly on network. Like, we don't have to shortchange the story, because when you read the books, it's not as if they're very violent or very sexually explicit, because that's not exactly this metaphor it's trading on either.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean that our characters don't have sex. And there's a lot of desire, and there's a surprising amount of violence that I'm surprised we got away with. But it's not in the same vein as True Blood, because it's not the same metaphor we're operating under. Because I did, when I read the books, when I first got the books, I was like, well, can you even do a Charlaine Harris thing on network? But when I read it, I'm like, there's absolutely no reason you can't do this book on network. There's nothing in the books that is saying to me. And, you know, we push the envelope as much as we can, and I've been really grateful that the network and the studio have been supportive.
Yeah.
So
I thought it was great, because I couldn't believe, I was like, wait, this is going to be on NBC? Because the scene with Lem and Olivia's character, where he asks her if he could take, you know, some of that pressure off of her, and I was like, is this really going to be on NBC? I was like, this is fantastic.
Oh, yeah, no, it's amazing.
Yeah. So I know that there's that undercurrent of sexuality,
yes.
and then there's also that grittiness, so I was just almost surprised that NBC was willing to like have that much in there, because usually you see stuff like that on a bigger.
But they're also the network that put on Hannibal for many years, so it's like they have pushed the envelope before, and I think they're letting us do a little bit of that now.
Is there a character from the book series that was particularly difficult for you to adapt into the television series?
Mr. Snuggly, because I'm so time-consuming and expensive.
But he had to be in.
But he had to be in. Yeah. He had to be in. Like, it would have been weird. It's part of what makes this book series different than True Blood, that it is, there's a whimsical quality to this world also, and a wish fulfillment to this world. It's like, after I read the books, I want to live in Midnight. I want to be able to go to Fiji store. So I think that, not really. I mean, it's been a real experience because also we've adapted some of the characters for the people we cast. So Fiji's backstory is a little different than the Fiji in the book. And Lem's backstory is a little different. But also, I tried to keep similar things. So Lem in the book, who was a sort of golem-like white character, he came from Texas. He was an old Texan. So we, you know, when we explored Lem's backstory, we kept him an old Texan. But his backstory would look very different considering Peter Mensa versus in the book. So we tried to sort of keep the heart and then adapt accordingly to who we cast and how we were evolving the stories.
So at the moment, you've got lots of different characters being brought into the fold. Who would you say is the heart of the show as we start off, and does that change?
Because I feel like it's hard for me to say because they're all such vital parts of the community. I feel like Fiji's the kindest. So to speak to heart, I think Fiji's the one that everyone loves, who doesn't have a mean bone in her body, who everyone can support, and is like just the best of everyone. And, you know, I think all our characters change over the course of the season. So, yeah, it does change. But, you know, I don't want to give anything away, so until you have.
Is there something about Midnight itself as a city or town that is integral to the story? Like, where it's at, what it is, and how does that play?
Well, it's on a veil. And Fiji talked about it being on a veil between the living and the dead. We learned more about that veil in episode 2, and we learned that that veil is porous. That veil is fraying. And so into this delightful little community of a found tribe where they're sort of left alone to be themselves, all hell's gonna break loose. And for people who just kind of want to be left alone, they're gonna have to decide, do we act? Do we help things? Do we leave? Like, we could leave. We could all just disappear. So so the town itself becomes integral to the story.
How involved is Charlaine in actually the series at all, or is she?
She came to sets. I've talked to her, but I mean, it's funny, when I first met her, she's like, well, I've been through this on True Blood. This is your show. I have my books. Mm-hmm. And she understands it, and so she's been super supportive. We send her every script. But in terms of, I have a wonderful group of writers who all read the books, and then we sort of just took it from there.
And we often see, especially on TV, that when you talk about the undead and the difference between the living and the dead, we usually see the dead as being the bad guys, the living and the good, fighting for their sort of living freedom. Is it going to be the same in Midnight Texas, or are you going to have sort of pockets of the undead helping the living?
I feel like for me, the living, because Manfred sees the dead, they're like us as humans. Harold is petty and mean and upset his wife is moving on. Zilda's protective of her grandson. Like, people are who, their souls are who they are. They're just, unfortunately for Manfred, in the body that died. But I think that, you know, one of the things that was important to me is that our ghosts aren't just spooky, because we live in a world of monsters. Our vampires aren't the scary ones. Our witches aren't the scary ones. So our ghosts shouldn't be the exclusive scary ones. Some ghosts are awful, but some are kind, and some are just lonely. And, you know, Aubrey just wanted help. And what I love is playing with that trope of, holy shit, there's a ghost. But it's a sad lady who just wants some help. So I like upsetting the expectations of what you think a ghost is going to be versus what it is. And for Manfred, ghosts are all things.
Can you talk a little bit about the scene with Aubrey going to Manfred for help after she's found, that scene, how was that filmed? Because it was so incredible, and just the way the actresses, the water is coming out
of her. It's amazing. That was a feat of movie magic. First of all, we had to build a room that could sustain that amount of water, so it had to be waterproof. Shannon.
Was it prosthetics?
Actor. It was. She was in a fat suit, and then the dead body overlaid and on it, because you know if a body's been in water for that long, it would.
Yeah.
You know, so we're trying to be realistic.
Yeah.
Among our dead.
Yeah.
And then there was a tube connected to a tank, so there's literally a man following her with a tube with a wire that goes in through the prosthetic and dripping water, and then we had to CG all that out. So it was a lot, but she was amazing.
Yeah,
and you got so much sadness in her dead eyes, like you felt for the dead girl, which was important to me, that it's not just a body, that there's a story behind that body, because for Manfred, those are the people he talks to.
There's conflicting stories about Aubrey's background, so
yes.
It's like,
and we'll learn more about that.
Yeah, like, do you have empathy for her, or do you
right.
think that she got what she deserved? It's very hard to decipher, but at that moment when she's like reaching out,
right, he wants to, yes,
yeah,
you want to,
like,
help her. And I think one of the things that's in Charlaine's book that we try really hard is every character in Midnight has been evil at some point or bad. And human beings can change, and people can change, and no one begins and ends in that one event. And so these are characters who are looking for redemption, and we'll learn that all their histories aren't great, but they've changed. And so it's important to always, like, for us to always just not characterize people as villains or good, but where are they in the desire to be different or to be good or to be human?
Yeah.